anarchist. I'm not an atheist or a theist. I'm just kind of a free thinker. And here's the thing I was thinking about. Somebody was, you know, getting in my case for I'm standing up for religion. You know, why do you do that? It's 2024. Aren't you more advanced? Or, you know, think of all the technology we have, these great, you know, artificial intelligences. And, you know, as in theology, think of the past. It's like you could have like 1,000 people, and 100 of those people are Christian. And I just use that because I'm in a Christian nation. Again, I was raised non-denominational Christian, but again, I don't identify as any one thing because I think it's all just a conscious experience. If you want to be an atheist, try studying atheism for a year, and you'll see like all these atheist doors open in your reality. Like you'll be like, oh, you'll be like identifying with like atheistic ideology. Same thing with theism. Just try for like a year and then see like everything. You'll start like meeting people and like having like Christian or religious experiences or atheistic experiences or whatever. Anyway, let's see if like 1,000 people, 100 of those people are Christian. Let's say those 100 people, they're not like the, like, you know, attack you type. You know, some people misinterpret religion as a tool. They're going to go out and like set someone straight. They're utilizing it in the proper way, let's say. And that's, you know, the golden rule, treat others as you're going to be treated, and that's basically it. You know, they're respectful, they don't shove their beliefs on people, they ask before they pray for you type thing, can I pray for you? They're not like shoving their prayers on you, telling you're going to go to hell. Anyway, the point is this, is that, and I think most of the Christian stuff is mostly a metaphor. If you kind of follow the whole story, you know, from the Old to New Testament, it seems more like something is this lesson of learning how to give up control and then crucify your old nature, and then from that be reborn into higher gnosis or understanding of being good to one another. That's just, I don't want to get into it. I could speak about that for 3-4 hours probably. The point is this, those 100 people, the way that they interpret something has a trickle-down effect in the 1,000. There's people within that 1,000 that don't even know, or there's people in that 900, I should say, that, let's say they're all atheists. They don't even know that the goodness that they feel from other people is a direct result from, let's say one of the atheists has a conversation with a girl named Stacy. Then that atheist goes off and talks to 3 to 4 to 5 other people. And that atheist didn't know that Stacy was a Christian. That kindness then spreads from all those other people. And, you know, the old saying, like, you know, if one's happy, other people are happy. Like, if you're at work, oftentimes, like, when one person's happy, it's, you know, the happiness is contagious. So it's kind of like what I'm getting at. They're not even aware that her faith is the thing that brought them happiness. It's not just her kindness, you know, it's her, literally her faith that made her react positively to this first person. That person is taking something which came from a Christian background. That person, that first atheist, is taking something that that came from that encounter with the girl Stacy from a Christian background, and then spreading it to those other people, and that, you know, gets spread from the 1 to 2 to 4 to 8 to 16. So you see how that works? Let's say you took that 100 out and replaced it with someone else, and someone might sit there and say, well, that's, you know, seems like you could put, you know, maybe 100 different types of other people in there, you know, Buddhists, Muslims, yeah, that works too. But there's just something about the morals, the ethics, the things associated with certain things that sometimes make people think, I need to be good to somebody. It's not what, you know, Young Dredd was doing on Instagram or, you know, some rap video where he was going to not let somebody tell him straight. You know, the person that's raised in the religious context might sit there and think that I need to sit here for a second and think, how do I want to be treated? You know, the lesson that my belief structure I'm aligning with is treat others as you want to be treated. It's not Young Dredd trying to be the hippest, fucking coolest, hardcore, whatever the hell, you know, on the block, you know, smoke a blunt and fuck them all type thing. You know, it's like the person's like, wait a minute, I need to slow down and think here. You know, what would these religious figures that I find inspiration from, what would they do in this situation? So you see how that works? Whether it's Hinduism, Buddhism, you know, whatever, it's irrelevant. The point is sometimes there are certain things found within that has shaped society for so long that it's almost impossible to stop that from happening. You know, you have religious affiliations with church, well, obviously churches, temples. Those things go into, you know, sectors with helping the homeless, with helping battered women, battered men, with helping prisoners, with helping hospitals. You have shriners, you have all sorts of stuff all over the place with religion has their hands into. If you just took all that stuff out, think you're gonna evolve something. It's already evolving because religion is there helping it evolve by having a lot of people that trust the kindness found within the messages of those things, pushing money into those things, that money's then being put into certain other resources and then being used to better the world for other people so that you don't have somebody sleeping on your lawn in a sleeping bag or whatever. You know, they're out there funding like a homeless outreach thing or something. So you see what I'm getting with this? Out of 1,000 people, if you had 100 that were some sort of religious affiliation and they thought that it was their goal and they were raised around this thing from birth, let's say, or maybe they became it later in life, but to treat others as you want to be treated, that's a powerful message. A lot of people in modern society in 2024 don't exactly identify with that ideology. You know, you have some people that do, but a lot of people, it seems like there's a lot of, me type thinking. You know, very selfish, very like they're on their phone all the time scrolling, seeing how they can be the baddest, on the block or whatever, the coolest person in their situation, the best person in their school. So they're trying to be relevant, but in trying to be relevant, they actually fall out of relevancy because then they start pushing people away, it seems like. I could be misconstrued in my thinking in this. I'm not, saying that I'm correct about anything, but it just seems like there are certain things that if you read like Ian McGilchrist has a book on Jonathan Sacks has a book on morality. And then Ian McGilchrist has a book, it's called The Master and the Emissary, I think it's called, don't quote me on that. But it's about your left and right hemispheres of your brain and how those things work together in order to create the way that we relate to the world. There's a lot of stuff in there how theology, religion, the mind that's actually tied to that, a part of our brain that's tied to that, is actually the part that dictates a lot of how we interact with people in the world. And how it actually helps spread morality. So it's just one of those things I think that we're not going to see an end to that type of thinking. It's like, sure, we might find some sort of advanced technology that's going to simulate something similar, but it's not going to take the place of those other things because those other things come from what I call worm consciousness. Worm consciousness is biological consciousness, something that's not input quanta of information to create a result. Rather, it's input information based on qualia, human experience, how we experience the world. And that is let's just say like warm experiences. You could say cold experience would be the quanta metallic, engineered, more material down to earth type thing, if you want to call it that. What do you want to say? Machine type thinking. A warm experience was something, cold experience would be the machine thing, the computer, or the smartphone. A warm experience would be a direct relationship with a person that has experienced what you have experienced too, or is aware of someone that has. So therefore, they're more open to understanding you because they've been through it before. You don't learn basketball from somebody that's never shot a basketball, and you're not going to learn how to play basketball from watching a YouTube video. You're not going to learn basketball from having Ghost Robotics or Boston Dynamics Robotics or whoever the hell stand there and have a robot shoot at a hoop because it has, some algorithm that it can, make the hoop every time and it's exactly perfect. So I do the mathematics to do that. That's not really beneficial to you. You need to have the hands-on, that warm experience with something that's living biologically, that understands what to do. So you see, that's what I'm getting at. Those people, there's a rich tradition found within religions that kind of warm experience that spreads from, do unto others as you would have others do unto you type message, which we see the golden rule through basically every religion practically. We see that comes from people being in a certain background, raised a certain way. A lot of people nowadays, it's a very me culture, very people focus on modernity. Modernity is good, but you want to sit there and honor your ancestors, your traditions, and where you came from. Without, doing that, there wouldn't be a smartphone with all your amazing apps on it and things if there wasn't a Thomas Edison. I think it's Thomas Edison, don't quote me on that. I'm probably saying that, or is it Graham Bell? Anyway, without the original phone, let's just say. So forgive me, I got to go to sleep here soon. I got to get up for work. I think Edison was a light bulb, Graham Bell was the phone. Anyway, the point is this, you get the point. You want to make sure that you're, not forgetting where you came from, basically. It's like somebody will sit there and you'll read these stories about kids that go to jail or prison. And, I used to speak with prison guards down in Atlanta, Georgia. And they'll sit there and tell you, this area I was in had a lot of people, if you didn't do well in school, then, you could become a prison guard. It's one of those types of areas. You didn't have to have much education. That place is basically like, you see these kids and they go and they kind of forget their tradition that they were raised in. They forget how their parents raised them. And the parents, let's say, were doing things right. It took, some like very out there circumstances, for the kids, you know, to actually, they had to make some mistakes before they actually grew up, basically. But it was by remembering that they weren't raised to steal, they weren't raised to do some things that they were doing, that actually kept them on the straight and narrow. So this is one way that that 100 religious adherents can actually have a very positive impact on the other 900 out of the 1,000. So it's just a thought I had. I'm sure you could take something like some quantum computer and, you know, some advanced AI and put them together and take every bit of religious information on the planet and then formulate something where it said, you know, take out everything that's not relevant for 2024, and I'm sure it would create a very large volume, you know, book with many pages, which would be relevant for 2024. So for somebody to sit there and say that certain things aren't relevant seems a bit haphazard. It seems a bit irresponsible. Doesn't mean you have to agree with what I'm saying. Doesn't mean you have to agree with being, you know, into, you know, theism or anything like that. You know, again, I'm not an atheist or a theist. I'm just a free thinker. It just means don't, you know, people say, let it go, you'll be okay. What letting it go means is, like, if I'm vegan, if I have a friend that likes Jack in the Box, and that friend wants to go there, and I think it's detestable, it's gross because it's meat, it's cheese, it's all these nasty things, in my opinion, but I'm there for, my friend is my friend. I'm not there to, like, judge him based on what they consume. So see how that works? I have to let go of the fact that that's his decision. His decision isn't hurting me. It might be hurting an animal, but that's his right to do that. So somebody says, oh, let go of religion, you'll be this whatever. It's not about letting go of religion. It's about understanding that people have the rights to do certain things. I mean, you can't, like, somebody's like, oh, well, then standing up for LGBTQs. Well, if you believe in LGBTQ rights, then why do you believe in LGBTQ rights but then put down religious people? It seems like, you know, well, what are you going to pick and choose? It just seems a little strange. You know, it's like somebody says, do you like fruit? You don't like just one type of fruit. You like fruit overall. There might be some ones that you don't like, but overall, you sit there and say you like fruit. Well, if you like freedom of speech, overall, you might not agree with everything that's in freedom of speech, like some of the, you know, white supremacy stuff or something associated with that. But overall, if somebody's doing it, they're doing it. I'm not condoning that. But if somebody's doing something like that and they're not truly harming someone, they're just doing it from a, let's say, political, it's something that, you know, fits something within their view of the world, that's their right to do that. As long as what they're doing is not violating the law, then that's their right. So it's kind of interesting when you think about that. So this is why I don't think religion or anything like that is ever going to really go anywhere. I think it's always going to be around us because it's so ingrained within us and everything that it's already touched. You know, it's a, you know, trillion-dollar industry. So when you think about that, it's not going anywhere. It might evolve, who knows what, in the future. But for right now, it's definitely, you know, it's here to stay as it's been here to stay. It's only evolving with us. It's creating a better place for us to live. It's really the only people that get it wrong. You know, it's like, it's easy to focus on a war with something. We have a terrorist group that's like, you know, 2,000 people strong, and they, you know, get news on the news for something. But news is meant to look for people that are doing crazy stuff. They're not, you know, news really isn't there to, they're not like searching for the positive stuff so much, it seems like, you know, because it's the sensationalized stuff that sells. So anyway, it's just a thought.